Hello, my name is Jack. I'm the owner of Silent Politics. If you have any question, just post it on YouTube, Facebook, and Twitter. Now, if you have heard about the recent 2020 presidential election in the United States, which was also coming on the same time the coronavirus outbreak, then yes, Joe Biden has been elected as President of the United States of America. The victory of Joe Biden was seen very positive by many leaders, and probably it is more than just that. It may also heal some America reputation. Joe Biden is seen by majority of leaders across the world, as well as majority of population, that he could heal the relation between the United States and the rest of the world, which have been heavily strained under the Trump government. Multinational organizations like NATO as well as the UN have also welcomed the election of Joe Biden. However, not all countries are happy with the election of Joe Biden as President of the United States of America. And I will highlight this country as one of the countries that is dissatisfied with the newly elected President of the United States of America. And this is Israel. Benjamin Netanyahu, the current Prime Minister of Israel, has also sent a message congratulating Joe Biden as the new President of the United States. However, his message, while smooth, was very uninspiring and sly, compared to how he congratulated Donald Trump, greatly and honorably. The behavior of Benjamin Netanyahu seemed to be very abnormal for any major pro-American leader at the time, but it reflects a greater image that could influence the Israeli behavior and its appreciation towards the 2020 presidential election in the United States. So why does Israel, a very small country in the Middle East, can have so much negative attitude toward the victory of Joe Biden as President of the United States in the 2020 election? Well, we will have to go to the history lesson. Well, the history of Israel is also the history of the Jewish people itself. The Jewish people have a very difficult history in 20th century. They suffer heavily from Nazi Germany's Holocaust policy initiated by Adolf Hitler, who himself extremely hates Jewish people. The significant loss of East Jewry population in Europe had prompted the Jewish diaspora to finally return to Palestine and restore what they believe as the promised land, which means they enter Palestine. The Jewish people have also recognized Palestine as the holy land of Jewish people, and they would determine to found the Jewish state, which they proclaimed as Israel in 1947. With support from the United Nations and made up by the United States and the Soviet Union at the time. However, not all countries are happy, and the Arab nations were very hostile to the establishment of Israel. They accused the Jewish settlers as illegitimate and rallied a large army to invade them. Over 7 Arab countries attacked the infant nation Israel in support for the Arab cause of the Palestinians. But this unity among the Arab army had led to their defeat, and Israel survived from this dark moment to finally become a nation as we see now. The Israel nation have later fought a number of wars, including the most famous 1967 conflict, which is called as the Six-Day War, where Israel army made a blitzkrieg, destroying the Egyptian, Syrian, Jordanian, and Palestinian resistance. This war was one of the most emotional ones in Israel history, and also a precursor to a major political shift by the United States of America with regard to fighting allies in the Middle East. It was the American support for Israel from 1967 onward provide a new power for Israel to challenge its Arab neighbor. In 1973, United States openly threatened other Arab countries for attacking Israel during the 1973 Israel-Arab conflict. Likewise, in 1978, the United States facilitated the peace talk between Israel and Egypt, ultimately resulting in establishment of relations between Egypt and Israel. Likewise, in 1994, the United States under President Bill Clinton have also managed to facilitate the establishment of relations between Jordan and Israel in what we know as the Oslo Accord. The United States and Israel are also strongly cooperate in the military front, in which the United States is Israel's largest military provider, and many Israeli military generals and officers study in the United States in response. This is also from Alexander Haig, the late Secretary of the State of the United States, to openly and proudly state that Israel is the largest American aircraft carrier in the world that cannot be sunk. However, that doesn't mean Israel and the United States does not have any diplomatic role. The most recent diplomatic role happened during the Barack Obama presidency from 2008 to 2016. During that era, Netanyahu and Obama have a very complicated and tense relationship. Obama has openly endorsed the nuclear deal with Iran and sought to affirm closer relations with Iran in trying to prevent Iran from achieving nuclear status. But this treaty was strongly opposed by Israel, and Netanyahu has considered it as a disaster. Netanyahu has also accused Obama of revealing the information about Israel's plan of using Azerbaijan to attack Iran. Azerbaijan is also a Shia country by majority, but it has a secular government and a friendly relation with Israel, which is Iran's arch foe. And from 1990, relations between Iran and Azerbaijan has been mostly poor, as sporadic tension always occurs between the two countries. So even when Israel and the United States are united about the Kurdish war in Iraq and Syria to free themselves from this nation, the problem with regard to Iran have deteriorated the relation between Netanyahu's Israel and Obama's America. The Iranian regime in 1979 have determined that it would not spare Israel, and the goal to destroy Israel will remain as their only goal. The Islamic clergy of Iran have continued to follow that path since the establishment of this state in 1979 by Ruhollah Khomeini, and now is Ali Khamenei. Because of Obama's move to achieve the nuclear deal with Iran, this has threatened Netanyahu, and also it represents a threat for Netanyahu's government and Israel's existence as a whole. Although Obama claimed that the deal would ensure Israel to not be attacked and will help Iran to open up to the world and to end the Islamic regime from achieving its stupidity of destroying Israel, it did not convince Netanyahu well, and Netanyahu sought to seek an alternative ally. The 2016 presidential election in the United States proved to be a golden chance, and Netanyahu backed Donald Trump in response. But his resort was not enough, and he needed another partner, as I told about an alternative ally that could achieve Israel's ambition. And Netanyahu found himself in a very close relation with Russia. In fact, since 2000, Putin government had developed a better reputation to its Jewish population. Putin have openly denounced antisemitism and has also promoted the right of Israel to exist, despite there have been a lot of difference between the two countries with regard to Syria, Iran, as well as Saddam Hussein, and Russia relation with various Arab countries. But the United States also have such thing, the Europeans also have such thing, and China also has such thing. So Netanyahu found that there's no reason to not cooperate with Russia. But what made Netanyahu so honest to trust on Russia was because during the 2016 election, Putin developed a similar affinity toward Trump, and Putin recognized Trump as his henchman, a person that would represent Russian need when it comes to the difficulty that happened across the world. Russia has been under sanction by Obama for its invasion on Ukraine, mostly because Russia instigates the annexation of Crimea and rebel in Donetsk and Luhansk of Ukraine. In 2018, Haaretz, the only Israel newspaper, had revealed that the Israel government had directly involved in the US election on behalf of Putin's Russia by hiring a number of Israeli lobby groups to support for Donald Trump in the presidential election. The highest profile target on the Mueller probe that Haaretz had revealed was Sheldon Adelson, a Jewish American businessman who was hailed from Ukraine. He donated over $500 million for Donald Trump during the presidential campaign in 2016, which in turn the money was believed to be also funded by the Russian government to help Trump win the election. It is not clear if Sheldon Adelson received this money from Russia. George Nader, a Lebanese businessman who had been accused of being a pedophile and previously by the Arab a Mossad agent, was the man who arranged a meeting in Washington between Israeli officials and other Arab officials on discussing peace effort in Palestine. During the 2016 election, he donated an unknown number of money to Donald Trump's aide and had also secretly arranged a meeting between Trump's campaign group and the Russian official to ensure that the election would go to the Trump way and will have Trump become president of the United States. He also forged a very close tie with Benjamin Netanyahu when Netanyahu was first elected as Prime Minister of Israel back in 1996. The Russian lawyer Natalia Pesenitskaya, who was invited by George Nader in an arranged meeting between Trump official campaigner and the Russian official back in 2016, was a person who gave the damaging information about Hillary Clinton. And she was also the man who facilitated for Trump campaign in also under secret with support from the Israeli official. As the list keeps increasing, as Haaretz revealed that a number of Russian and Ukrainian officials have also involved alongside with the Israeli official on meddling the election in favor of Trump. Denis Kassim, a Russian tycoon who owned Prevezon and had a role in bringing Natalia Veselnitskaya to Trump campaign group, was also a major member who donated money for Trump official. The other is Vladimir, who is a diamond tycoon and is known as the Russia King of Diamond. Also found that to facilitate a number of money transporting from Israel to finance for Trump election. The third one is Roman Abramovich, the owner of Chelsea, a famous English football club, has also been thought to have donated money for Donald Trump, though his involvement was rarely understudied. The other is Viktor Pinchuk, a Ukrainian businessman. While he had an Ukrainian citizenship and also owned a religious institution in Israel as well, he seemed to be widely working with Russian officials on helping Trump to win the election. Of course, with Israeli official under Netanyahu as a third-party mediator. But yeah, no matter what happened back in 2016 election in the United States, the fact that Russia offered political support and helping Israel to achieve the win over for Donald Trump was considered as a significant move, and this helped boost the relation between Israel and Russia to what would be unbelievable high since 2016 onward. In 2020, Russia emerged as a major trade partner for Israel in Europe, which was considered as a big boost. At the same time, Netanyahu frequently participated in Victory Day commemorial to remember the fallen Soviet soldier back in World War II, of course. Since Trump became president of the United States as well, Netanyahu had a significant influence and in a way it dictates the American policy freely. It was Israel that pressured Trump, which Trump eventually did by withdrawing from the Iranian nuclear deal in the first place. It was Israel that also pressured Trump to meet the Russian leader Putin in Helsinki and pressuring the United States to stop sanctions on Russia and impose sanctions on Turkey, as well as making direct threat to Ukraine by requesting the United States to watch out Ukraine, believing that Ukraine aligned with Turkey represents a new threat as well, because Turkey is trying to restore the Ottoman Empire under the Erdogan leadership, and Israel has been taken target by Erdogan. Likewise, Putin also has a strained relation with the Iranian leadership. While Russia and Iran are formally allies, the Russian government has largely disapproved Iran's attempt to Islamize the whole region. The Russian government believes that their only option is to accept a secular Sharia, no matter how totalitarian Assad is. But Iran has a bigger ambition. It did not just stop in taking over this nation. It wants to install a similar government like the Iranian one to serve Iranian ambition. This has made the Russian government wary about Iran, and the cooperation with Israel has been boosted in the same manner. Moreover, when Donald Trump negotiated for peace between Israel and various Arab countries like Bahrain, United Arab Emirates, and Sudan, of course, what happened changed on the Russian attitude was the support from Putin's Russia to such these negotiations and eventual agreement that led to Abraham Accord between Israel and Bahrain to the United Arab Emirates. Previously, it would not happen under Obama, as Russia would oppose such a move. But under Trump, Putin's Russia have opened the green light for such a motive because for unknown reason. And this remains unclear why the Russia approved Trump, but not for the previous president of the United States to do so. However, these things would have not been taken notice if not for the coronavirus outbreak in 2020, which have disrupted many of Netanyahu plans and revealing on the dark side of both Trump, Netanyahu and Putin as well. The fact that unites both the behavior of Trump, Putin and Netanyahu to one was how both these leaders disregard the coronavirus outbreak as the first place and leading to the disastrous outcome. But Trump government openly did not think coronavirus as a threat, and he did not care about this. Not just that, he openly denounced wearing masks, as well as refusing to do anything to handle the coronavirus outbreak. He also did not organize any commission to handle it. So the United States, from having a golden chance to contain it, had wasted it, and coronavirus has spread to the country uncontrolled. Because Trump did not install any control system, the United States has the highest case of coronavirus infection as well as the death in the world. Russia, likewise, have also suffered what would be the worst coronavirus outbreak in Europe, with more than 1 million infected as well as nearly 1,000 dead in the country, which we consider as a strain for Russian health industry in the country. And what about Israel? Netanyahu, similar to Trump and Putin, also disregard the coronavirus and did very little to contain that. Thus, despite Israel is a major technological hub and also one of the most technologically advanced nations in the Middle East, Netanyahu's failure to detect the coronavirus outbreak had led to the death of thousands of Israeli citizens in the country. And Israel had only had 7 million population, and such casualty is one of the highest in the Middle East, despite the country has a significant resort to do that. Netanyahu also faced similar charge of corruption and nepotism at home, which had led to protests against him. Many Israelis have accused Netanyahu of being corrupt and trying to turn Israel into a totalitarian nation. The failure of Netanyahu to fight coronavirus outbreak at home has further exacerbated the tension. But many Israelis have accused Netanyahu of using his foreign diplomatic success to hinder and deny his failure at home. Said Netanyahu, like Trump and Putin, is a very short-sighted person. He only continued caring about diplomatic success abroad to ensure that he will gain popular support, while ignoring the ongoing deterioration of his image at home, as well as the increasing competence of the coronavirus outbreak, when Netanyahu was accused of doing nothing to deal with such outbreak to come. Of course, Netanyahu does have his right. Under his current government, Israel has achieved a greater friendly relation with most Arab countries because they both fear Iran and see Iran as a threat for the survival of many Arab nations. Also, Israel has improved ties with so many countries in the world, especially among the Muslim world, to deter the ongoing aggressive behavior of Iran, as well as the growing imperialist ambition of Turkey under Recep Tayyip Erdogan. So, the success of his diplomatic mission abroad perhaps can represent Netanyahu what he can achieve for, at least if Donald Trump continue to be elected as president. However, the 2020 presidential election did not produce the result which Israel had hoped for. Joe Biden and his runmate Kamala Harris have won the election and bring back the power back to the Democrats after 4 years under a very vigorous, unstable Trump administration. The defeat of Trump was considered as one of the biggest blows for both Netanyahu and Putin, who have seen Trump as like kind of their assets serving for this ambition. Biden's victory on his presidential campaign this time could represent a detrimental problem for Netanyahu. Biden could undo a lot of Trump policy, which have been overwhelmingly favored for Israel in the past. And also, Biden would ensure that Israel would continue to be an ally. But the tight relations that Netanyahu may experience with Obama could return. Biden was the vice president under Obama administration for over 8 years, and Biden shared many philosophies with Obama on his presidential campaign. And there's no doubt that Netanyahu disliked the success of Joe Biden. As I've told before, Netanyahu have sent a message to congratulate Biden to become the next president of the United States of America. But his message was very uninspiring. It indicated that Netanyahu would displeased with the victory of Joe Biden, and he would have to seek for an alternative friend because he could not trust the president of a party that opposing many Israeli ambitions to be in charge of the United States of America. Fear of the next 4 years in the United States may also prompt the Israeli leadership to rethink about their value on its relation with Russia. Although the value on relation between Israel and Russia is still quite low, it can be elevated to higher and higher because Netanyahu realized that Putin is the only person that would offer Israel anything they could. Not just that, the relation between Israel and Russia would have radically improved when Trump became president of the United States, would be likely to be maintained under Netanyahu. And as long as Putin continues to be in charge of Russia, it would be hard to break it down. The strategic location of Israel also plays a significant role as well. Lying in the heart of the Middle East, it had also faced a lot of external invasion before, mostly by the Arab force, over their hostility toward her existence. So, under the new Joe Biden presidency, when he could be possibly revoking many Trump policy, the good relation with Russia is extremely important, if not to say required, for Israel to make it under pressure for the other Arab country, which traditionally have good relations with Russia, of course. But even when you say so, It should be underlined that the United States relations with Israel are too important to fall. The loss of such a relation would be a disaster for American diplomatic mission, and the United States would be unlikely to antagonize Israel, no matter which leader in charge. So I expect Joe Biden would not be that stupid to antagonize relations with Israel, even though Joe Biden, on my opinion, is aware of Israel's connection to Russia, as well as the increasing Israeli-Russian alliance that would frustrate the relation between the United States and Israel. Thus, in my opinion, I believe that the relation between the United States and Israel in this phase will rely heavily on how Joe Biden would deal with Netanyahu. Netanyahu wants to commit the hawkish policy as long as he could, while Joe Biden wants a moderate and friendlier diplomacy that would serve the interests the United States feel to be possible, as well as not antagonizing Israel. So the United States is the best choice, I think, until 2021. We will see how Biden deal with Israel on this phase of relation, especially when Biden had to deal with a very hawkish and pro-Trump person like Netanyahu in charge of power. And thanks for watching. I'm the owner of Silent Politics. If you have any questions, just ask me on Facebook and Twitter or in YouTube. Thank you.